Listen, we're just happy that every one of you here, we bless for all of you that are watching us right now on FaceStream, or you're watching by the YouTube, or you're watching on the web. We're really blessed and honored to have Evangelist Tim Hall with us tonight. And I just want to, you know, kind of zoom in on this for me. Tim just finished this book, My First 40 Years in Power Evangelism. And so you can go on Amazon and you can purchase this book. Did you get a good close-up view of it? And those of you guys who are doing School of the Spirit with us, this would be a great book for you to have and go through and just encourage your faith. Know that what God's done through Jesus Christ, He wants to do through you. And then also, we have all these witnesses that come along through the generations since Jesus and prove to us over and over again that what He said is true. And so just grab a hold of these things and enjoy what it means to live out the life and ministry of our wonderful King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. So I'm not certain what Tim's going to minister on, but it's going to be good, and hopefully he's going to talk some about the word of knowledge. You know, just think about it. Understanding how the gifts of the Spirit function, what they are, how they function, how to move in them, the reality of, like, for example, the discerning of spirits. We just get sharper in the discerning of spirits. I believe we can understand every blockage that would stand in the way of us being able to effectively minister to people that don't seem to get healed or delivered or whatever. But you know what? We're at this thing and committed to it, hungry, thirsty for the things that God has purposed for us to do so that we can be as effective as God has ordained for us to be. These works and greater works. And everyone, not just some people, everyone. I'm going for 100% of the people in the name of Jesus. They're healed, whether they get saved or not. That's another issue. Healed in Jesus' name. Delivered, set free. Everybody, welcome Tim. Evangelist Tim Hall.
Well, let's stay down here or go up the top. I might get the pulpit down. Is that okay?
Somebody get that down.
Yeah. We got a whole team going here. Well, it's a great opportunity and a great privilege to share with you tonight. And these are exciting days. I mean, no, these are exciting days. These are the most exciting days that a Christian could ever be called. There's never been an opportunity on the planet like we have right now. The greatest harvest in world history is available right now. The greatest opportunities to be carriers of the power of God is right now. Nations in unrest, multitudes in the valley of decision, and it is a joy. I'm an evangelist. I travel the world. I don't know how many countries a year we go to, but I'm looking at my diary this coming year and this year, and I'm already weary just looking at the calendar. But the joy is to be traveling from place to place, ministering in the power of God. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, would you anoint the word tonight in a powerful way? I pray, Father, that you'd help me to really open some things wide tonight. And I thank you that something positive is going to come into every life watching online or sitting here tonight, that God's going to touch you. And I thank you now, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a scripture that I've been toying with and working with for some time. I've actually preached from it here not that long ago, but I'm going to open it up further tonight. But I want us to look, if you have your Bible, turn to the book of 2 Corinthians and chapter 10. I want to look at a few words here, a few verses. Verse 3 and into 4. And it says this. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 and 4. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, not natural, but divinely powerful through God to the utter demolition of fortresses. Then it says, we are pulling down, or if you like, demolishing every high thing. Imaginations, the word logismos. We're demolishing, pulling down things raised up against the knowledge of God, imaginations, reasonings, and every high thing raised up against the knowledge of God, and we're bringing every thought captive unto the obedience of Christ. Goes on and says we're ready to punish disobedience, etc. Scripture says, though we walk in the flesh, we're peripateia, we're walking around in a body. We're in a body tonight. When I got up this morning, I found myself in this body. A lot of room to move around in this one. But we all are living in this thing. We can't get out of it. We belong in it. It's our earthly vehicle. It's the temple of God. But we're in this body. I have a friend. He loves to say, he says, I meet certain people and I would hate to be inside their head. And none of us will ever know what it's like to be in someone else's head. We're all living, and we've actually got no idea what it would be like. I don't know. I know that a lot of people definitely wouldn't like to be in my head. My head's fullest. I start cartooning and people say, is that in your head? Yes. But we walk around in the flesh. We walk around in a natural realm. We eat, we sleep, we walk around in the flesh. But the Bible says here, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. The Greek word stratumai means our campaign, our military camp. We're in a campaign. We're in a military campaign tonight. Whether we like it or not, we're in a campaign with an enemy that hates us. If we're wanting to move forward in God, we are confronting forces and powers and principalities. We are in a warfare. In fact, the Bible speaks a lot in military terms. It talks a lot in terms of military things. It talks about enduring hardship as a good soldier. Paul wrote to Timothy and spoke to him in military terms. He said, Timothy, endure hardship as a good soldier. If you were a Roman soldier, your training was absolutely brutal. A 25-mile route march had to be completed in 5 hours, fully loaded with about 80 or 90 pound or more in weight, all of the weapons and everything else. And it was not that, it was a very, very quick walk to cover the distance, and you couldn't lag back. The discipline in the Roman army was extreme. They talk of the Roman training and they said the training is battle without blood, and the actual battles were training with blood. They were so similar. Romans were trained and disciplined to an extreme place. And the scripture says, Paul said, endure hardship, endure it as a warrior. And so, the Bible also says in 2 Timothy 2:4, no man that wars involves himself with things of the world. If we're in a battle, if we're serving Christ, don't get involved in a whole lot of worldly stuff. In 1 Timothy 6 verse 12, it says, fight the good fight of faith. Paul, at the end of his life, the old warrior in the Roman prison, the Mamertine prison in Rome, getting ready to die at the hands of Nero. He knew he was not going to come out that second time from the prison. He was on death row, and Nero was going to take his life. He knew that. But right at the end, he says, I fought a beautiful fight. I fought a good fight. And in these two verses, fighting a good fight of faith, the words, two words used there are agon and agonizomai. The agon, from which we get agony, and agonizomai, a strong, intense struggle against a powerful foe. And Paul says, I have been involved in a beautiful war against a powerful foe, an agonizing struggle in the arena of faith. I've fought one and it's been beautiful and I'm ready to go. The old warrior. Jesus is called the captain of our salvation. And we read about the weapons of our warfare in Ephesians 6. But here it says, though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. This battle we're in is not natural. Beautiful thing is that it's a battle that we are born to win. If Christ be for us, who can be against us? In all these things, the Bible says we are overwhelming conquerors, more than conquerors. The Greek word there speaks of an unstoppable, over-the-top, conquering warrior who really can't be defeated. We are born to win. If through one man's sin death reign, how much more shall we, who have received the gift of righteousness, reign as kings, rule, live in dominion as kings by one Christ Jesus? We are the head, not the tail. We are above only. We're never below. God is raising up as unstoppable warriors. But he says, we're in the flesh, but we're in a great battle. It's an exciting battle. It's a warfare. We know it. If we're serving God, we know it. People that are nominal Christians are probably not aware. But once you start to get serious about doing something for God, it doesn't take very long. Once you set your mind that you're going to go after God, you're going to seek the face of God, it takes a very short space of time before you realize that you have an enemy who wants to put you off and discourage you and get into your mind and get into your thoughts and create situations to try to slow you down and stop you because he fears you. The Bible says that we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare, he says, you're not going into this thing unequipped. You're not going into this thing unequipped. In Ephesians 6 verse 10, it says, the challenge is there. It says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. That word strong in dunamu, to be in the dunamis, in the dynamic, supernatural power and ability of God. And in his might, the word there, kratos, is dominion, power, eruptive power, dominion of God. And so the Bible says there, finally, my brethren, be strong, be infused with the power of God and the power of his dominion and his forcefulness. But if you're going to be like that, you better make sure that you have on, put on, be clothed into the full armor of God. The word full armor there probably is better translated the full weaponry. Panoplia, from two words, pass, all, and hoplon, weapons. Put on the whole weaponry of a fully armed Roman legionnaire. Put it on. He says, because you're in a battle. He says, you're wrestling. You don't wrestle. The ancient means of the ancient martial arts of boxing. Boxing was brutal. Boxing was so brutal. Leather straps that wrapped around hard leather that created knuckle dusters that even had raised sections of leather to cut the face and damage the enemy. Boxing was brutal. Brutal, a bloody sport that left many people dead. One of the ancient Greek writers wrote that one man was using the cestus of his brother in the next fight, and before he did, he had to clean off the brains of his brother's last opponent. And wrestling was brutal. Wrestling was such that you could gouge an eye or break a spine, bring that person to submission, bring them down, either to submission through pain or pressing them down in total submission. And that is the devil's aim, his aim. The scripture says, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, Methodius, the mind games of the devil. Put on the whole armor of God, that in this great battle, you are going to have the full armor so that you can stand against his mind games, his tricks, his techniques. And one of the greatest things that we will confront and that people confront is mind games, battles in the mind. Greatest battle I'm ever going to have is in my own mind. Greatest struggle that we as Christians have is in our own mind. The devil will endeavor all the way to confuse you, to make you feel as though you can't do it, that you're inadequate for the task, that all these things. But God's got a plan. And he's greater. The greater one is in us. Greater is he that's in us than he that's in the world. The head, not the tail. My Bible says we're above only. If there's a wrestling match, we are above only, never below. We're not the one on the mat. We're the one taking control. We are born to rule and reign. We're born to take control. So we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and world rulers and wicked spirits in the heavenly places. But then Paul says, you better take up that armor. It's like a military instruction. What are you doing in this battle without your armor? You know, the more hungry we are to go to the nations and to do something profound in the nations, the more it is totally essential that we are wearing the full armor of God, that we are totally equipped with all the weaponry. I've had the thrill of preaching in a lot of countries that a lot of people don't want to go into, and at times that have been really times you probably wouldn't go in there. But you know, there's something about going in there knowing that you are clothed with the full armor of God, that you clothed with his presence and power, that it's over you, that the shield of faith is in your hand, that you're standing strong, that you know who you are, you know what you're carrying, you have on the breastplate of a relationship with God that can't be stopped, and your sword is sharp and razor sharp, and your shield is prepared, and the ancient Roman shield had to be pampered. That shield was pampered. The shield was such a vital part of the battle, and it had to be soaked with oil. Every day they would soak it with oil, and then before the battle they'd put it into water, and the water would get in under the leather so that shield was supple and such that every fiery dart that hit it would be expunged. And we have to nurture our faith like that. We've got to be dipped in the anointing of the Holy Ghost, soaked in the Word of God. The shield of faith demands it. The shield of faith, the shield of our faith grows in our relationship, our understanding of who we are through both his presence, his power, time spent in prayer, and strong periods of time soaking his word. Though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. The weapons of our warfare are not natural, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. The word to pull down means demolish, even to extinction of strongholds. We live in a world right now that is a world of strongholds. The devil is the master at building strongholds. Back in the 60s, there was a band, I think it was Pink Floyd or one of those bands, put out an album called Just Another Brick in the Wall. And what happens over the years is that in society, it is as though walls are built around people. Humanistic teaching. Teaching that's anti-God. Teaching that comes from man. Because what has happened in the last numbers of generations is that instead of people worshipping the great I am, they worship the here I am. And humanism just replaces the great I am with I'm the I am. And then the philosophies build in our society. And our society starts getting brainwashed by ideas built around man being God and not God being God. I was born in 1948, which is a long time ago. I was in the School of Art in South Australia in the 60s. I studied 3 years at South Australian School of Art, and it was an interesting time. I missed going to Vietnam by one day. Some of my friends went off to Vietnam and came back pretty messed up, badly received when they got home. But it was a time that was a crazy time. But in our generation, my time on the planet, I've really watched a mindset on the planet changing with strongholds being built on a big scale and on individual scales. We've got strongholds being built in kids' lives through the texting, where kids are so bullied and so put down that they start to build a thing around themselves which locks them into such a degree that we've got kids suiciding left, right, and center because of brutal texting. But I remember back as a young man in the 50s, 90% of people in America in the 50s believed strongly And I'm going to talk, I'm leading into the gifts of the Spirit and their application. So just bear with me for a moment. In the late 50s, America was losing the space race. And there's a lot of talk of Russia being ahead. The Sputnik had been sent up. Yuri Gagarin had gone into space. And there was a push in 1958. And there was, the thought was, Russia are ahead in science. They understand science better. And we had a flood in the late 50s in America that spread right through the Western world, where school books were put in vast numbers into our high school, into our schools, that were pushing evolution. Evolution to celebrate Charles Darwin. Back in 1858, celebration was there that Darwin had the answers. And we all know that evolution makes about no sense. A human being can't exist in stages. I don't care how many trillion years a human being exists complete. And so you had a mentality coming that says there is no God. When you've got a mentality that starts to say there is no God, then all of a sudden you've got a world that where there's great questions about morality and ethics and who we are and what's right morally and what's wrong and everything else. And man wants his own way and he wants his own plans and he wants to be satisfied and he's got rights. And all that started back there in the 50s. Then in the 60s, things went haywire, a lot through music. There were all sorts of things happening with mind control, and out of that, LSD was being used in tests, and that took off and that spread out through some of the people involved with it. And it wasn't long before LSD was everywhere and all over. Much started here in California. The Beatles are over here. So many of the music groups got involved in it. And then music went from love ballads to the weirdest stuff you could imagine. I remember the Beatles, sort of the stuff they sang in the beginning was all love this, love me do, can't buy me love, love this, love that, etc. And then by the end, it was I am the walrus, I'm the Eggman, I'm the walrus, Rukukutu, I am you, you and me. And insane stuff. And the music groups were getting into this stuff, and a whole generation was now being led with a control of the mind that says it's free love, free sex. This is our time, talking about our generation. And we watched things accelerate in the 60s where the music groups of the world began to set the pattern of how youth should live. No longer the parents. The movies began to present a whole lot of stuff. And the devil from the 60s, particularly, there was a revolution that where the minds of a generation began to be shaped and controlled. There's stuff now that we hear being legalized that 20 years ago, 25 years ago, no one would have believed that these things would even come to the table. Stuff happening that we never would have believed. And if you go to the university and you talk about believing in creation, you'll be laughed to the ground. If you stand up against some of the moral conditions today, you'll be called a hater. How then do we as Christians deal in a world right now that to a great degree has left the foundation of Scripture and is following its own course, its own direction? What I want to do, I can do. It's a generation that says every person's got their rights. How can we, in this great situation as preachers, as Christians, what is God's keys to breaking through in this realm of the mind? What is His key? What are His keys in breaking strongholds against a generation? I was in the School of Art. I studied in the School of Art. I went to Teachers College. Just about everything when I was at the Teachers College that was taught was humanistic or Marxist or out there somewhere. And so through our education system, universities that began were the most important part of a university was the chapel, to a place today where, to a great degree in our schools, prayer was stopped, legal situations took place, particularly through one woman. Prayer was out of the schools, and we watched strongholds being built, powerful strongholds. And so the question that I ask as a preacher, what are the keys that God has given us to break these strongholds? There are people out there that if you try and talk to them about God, they've already made up their mind, they've built a stronghold around themselves, and as you share with them, you can't get through. How do you get through? What do you do to get through there? What do we do to break open our universities? Because for the future, we need some preachers in the power of God who are going to stand up in schools and universities under such an anointing of God that all the philosophy of the world cannot stand against the raw manifestation of the power of God. So how do we break through? What is our key to touching a generation that are getting so set in their mind that they think they have it all worked out? But as you share with them, they know. You can't talk them. You can't talk them through. Persuasive words of the wisdom of men don't work. Trying to debate with them at an intellectual level, well, I'm not much good at that. Although I think a lot of stuff that's believed is so crazy that my three-legged cat with a glass eye has got better scientific understanding. How do we break through strongholds? Where do we start in breaking strongholds? Let me go to the Bible, because Jesus made it very clear that strongholds are going to be broken by mighty weapons. Go with me to John 4. Some of you have probably heard me share on this here before. I think it's one of the strategic stories. John chapter 4. The Bible says that Jesus was in Samaria, a place called Shechem. And he was with his disciples, and Jesus was thirsty, they were hungry, and the disciples went down to the town to buy some food, and Jesus stayed at the well. And it must have been a hot day, I think. And they were wearied. He was journeying. And Jesus, as he sat there, a lady walked up, probably with a big container on her head, to take water back to the town, back to her home, as she would do so often. As she came up there, Jesus said to her, "Woman, would you get me a drink?" The woman was shocked for a number of reasons. She was shocked because he was a Jew. She was a Samaritan, and not only that, worse still, she was a Samaritan woman, because in her own words, she said, "You guys have nothing to do with us." This, if you want to see the picture today, this is one of your formal Jewish, what's the word, with the guys with the big curls and the hat. Yep. Sitting up there, and up comes a young Palestinian girl. And he says to her, "Would you get me to drink?" It's a very similar situation. It wouldn't happen. Jesus begins to talk to her. And let's pick this up. Jesus starts to talk to her, and she says, verse 9, "Then said the woman of Samaria, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans." Jesus answered and said unto her, now this is the Son of God. The anointing must have been strong. You have the feeling that when he would speak to you, he said, "The words that I speak, John 6:63, they are spirit and they are life." You'd surely pick something up. And he said, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that is speaking to you, saying, "Give me to drink," you would have asked of him and he would have given you living water. That's a very powerful invitation to really know the Messiah and to be flooded with his blessing. We read that. If you knew the gift that I have for you today, said Jesus, and who it is that's speaking to you, you would have asked of me and I would have given you living water. The woman is closed. She got a stronghold built around her life. She's locked into a life that doesn't let God in. Her life is such that it's sealed in a stronghold that holds her in. And so she said to him, "Sir, you haven't got anything to draw with. This well is deep. Where are you going to get that living water?" She is thinking totally carnally and his word has not got through. You will find that there are people like that. You talk spiritual things and you look at them and they are blank. I've preached to congregations like that. She said, "You've got nothing to draw with. How are you going to get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us this, the well. He drank there himself, his children, his cattle." Jesus said unto her, "Whoever drinks of this water here is going to thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up unto everlasting life." I don't think that's vague. He said, "Madam, I'm not even talking about this water. I'm talking about a different water, a living heavenly water, heaven's water, that will flow out of your innermost being like a great wellspring of life and blessing." She said, "No." The woman said, "Sir, can you get me this water so I don't thirst not? I'm sick of coming here to draw the water." This lady is locked in to her own world. She is in a stronghold. You can't reach her. Can't reach her. So Jesus says, "Go call your husband, come back. Go get your husband and come back." And the woman answered and said, "I don't have a husband. I don't have one." And Jesus, and I can imagine the look on his face as he turned. Jesus turned and he said, "Yeah, you said that well. You've had five. The man you're with now, you're not even married to." You know what happened? That word of knowledge knocked those bricks out of that stronghold so quick and allowed suddenly the light of the gospel to come in. When we're out preaching big open areas, some nights you feel God say, "Get some people up here on the platform." One night, I think it was in Samoa, before I preached, one of the islands, got a whole bunch of people on the platform. Said, "Bring up all the deaf people." We do that quite regularly down there. "Bring up all the deaf people." I don't know why, but it seems to be an open area to get the deaf healed. And just start praying for them. The power of God hits them and they're hearing, speaking. Suddenly, every obstacle is broken. That miracle, the miracle in one moment blows away 1,000 mindsets. People say, I don't believe in Christ. I don't believe in him. And then something very miraculous happens to them, and they don't know how to explain it. There is no explanation. How did that happen? How did that just happen to you? Who did that? See, every miracle does a certain thing. Every time there's a miracle, Acts 4:33 says, with great power, they bore witness of the fact that Jesus was raised from the dead. He's filled us with resurrection power. And every time there is a manifestation of that power, be it a word of knowledge, be it a powerful miracle, it is a demonstration of the fact that Jesus Christ is alive from the dead. Every miracle we see says he's still alive. Jesus said this, he said, you shall receive power. Acts 1:8, we all know it. You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you to bear witness of me. The word martis basically means to bear legal witness. Witness that will stand up in a court of law. He said, you'll go out after the Holy Ghost comes upon you bearing legal witness that cannot be disputed. By demonstrated power, you're going to bear witness. Acts 4:33, with great power, they bore witness that would stand up in court. In fact, it stood up so well that the Pharisees began to say, you have filled the city with your doctrine. Miracles break a place open. I went to Guadalcanal a few years ago, had the privilege of preaching on a battle site in Guadalcanal. This was the first ever major crusade I did. I preached on this battle site. It was one of the hardest times of my life. I was in the darkest hours of my life. And I preached there, and I remember preaching, and the first night we had 1,000 people. And I thought, God, this big football ground, just 1,000 people in the middle. I thought, God, it's not many here. But I still felt the power of God. And that night we had a couple of significant miracles. Next night the crowd was out to about probably 4,000. And then the Lord spoke to me. He said, Tim, tomorrow night, tell them that heaven's going to come down here. Well, the following night, I'll never forget. On one side of the platform, they brought a man lying on a bed, just a rolled up bed, and he lay there on the ground, and as he was lying there, they were fanning him and trying to keep people back from him. He'd had probably meningitis or something like that, and he'd been in a comatose state. They'd fed him with liquids and kept him alive. That's about all that's happening. And he's lying there in a vegetative state. And as I was preaching, I'll never forget the end of that meeting. The power of God came down like a cloud out of heaven. And over on this side, miracles started to happen. I remember some deaf ears were opening and people were starting to shout here. And then I heard a near riot break out. And I looked over here and they were screaming and shouting. And the guy had got off the bed and he was holding the bed, waving the bed. And I said, bring him up. And we brought him onto the platform. The whole crowd went crazy. They began to shout. They began to scream. And within the next few nights, the place was so packed, we didn't even have room for an altar call at the front. The grandstands were full. The ground was full. The government put on buses. Kids were escaping from their dormitories at the school. The place was jam-packed. The last night, there must have been 4,000 or 5,000 got saved. I remember walking amongst them, tears running down their face. But the miracles were opening it up. Miracles and demonstration of the Spirit of God smash open Every wall that's raised against the knowledge of God comes down and is demolished. 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 So what is God doing? the move of God that America needs and the Western world needs is not built around good evangelical preaching. Although we need good evangelical preaching. But as the Apostle Paul said, I didn't come amongst you to the Corinthians. He said, when I came amongst you, I determined something. I determined that I was going to know nothing amongst you save Christ and Him crucified. In Athens, he had tried to, it was a very smart sermon on Mars Hill in Athens. It was a clever sermon, but it didn't leave much. When Paul came down to Corinth, he said, when I got here, I determined it's going to be different. You see, when I came, I determined to know nothing amongst you save Christ and Him crucified. He said, I was in much fear and trembling, but he said, my preaching was not with the persuasive words of the wisdom of men. I wasn't going to try and persuade them. He knew that when he came into Corinth, there were strongholds there that only the miraculous power of God was going to break. When he came into Corinth, he knew Corinth, if he tried to just debate it and come up with persuasive words, he would have been laughed off. He was really laughed off in Athens, called a babbler. Let's hear this babbler again. Just another person up there doing his best. But he said, in Corinth, I made my mind up, it was going to be different. And he came in there. And he came in demonstration and power and hit that place with everything. And then as we read the book of Corinthians, it must have caught on, because that church was a church that was short in no gift. In fact, we want to know about the gifts of the Spirit. We go to 1 Corinthians 12, and there we find that it was to the Corinthian church he was writing, saying, this is how you operate these gifts that you've got. He says, you got these gifts. He said, those of you that haven't, he said, pursue love. Make that your first goal. But keep earnestly desiring the spirituals, especially that you might prophesy. And he talked about the manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit. I think God is putting out an invitation to his church and saying, come in. It's, I think in Jeremiah 50 it says that the doors of his armory are open. Read David's mighty men. That all the weapons of war, all the instruments, they keep rank. Yeah. The doors of his armory is open. The door of his armory is open. That's a word from God tonight. That's a word from the Lord tonight to you and I. I mean, some people say we don't need the gifts today. Well, don't you worry. I will go in and I'll get your share. And if I go into his armory, I'm not going to go in there and say, yes, I think I'll just take that little pocket knife there. Or what about the BB gun? No, I'll take that tank. Put me in that Abrams tank. No. Put me in an aircraft carrier. No. Load me up. I walk out of that place so loaded up. I don't know what you want. I don't know what you want out of the armory. I don't know what you'd be satisfied with. Pastor Mark, he'd be coming out there with a... I dread to think what he'd be. I don't even want to think about it. He'd fly out of there in a stealth. A lot of people, yes, well, you know, the gifts passed away when the last apostle died. Bull! Rubbish! If ever we need the demonstrated power of God, it's right now. If ever we've needed people that would say, I am going with prayer and fasting into the armory because the doors are open. Where are the prophets prophesying with their eyes ablaze with fire? Where's the healing gifts? Somebody said, Tim, when are you going to retire? I said, you're so rude. What am I supposed to do? Buy a cat. Get my own cat. And sit in a rocking chair. And do the Sudoku and go and get the paper. Read the sports section. No! No! No, why? It's a world out there going to hell. You're looking for people all shapes and sizes. Young, old, medium, ancient. I mean, we need old grand. I got my granddad. I got 10 grandkids. But I mean, if you're 95, praise God, brothers and sisters. A great meeting tonight. It's going to be. We're going to have children moving in the gifts of God with such accuracy. Little kids. Are going to stand up and we're going to stand back and go, oh gosh. What do you want to carry? Watching online, what do you want to carry? What do you want to carry? The armory is open. The armory's open. I'll have some of those. Some of that. Couple of those. Let's go. We're going to action. We've had nights where I remember waving my hand and from front to back that thousands and thousands of people just falling out under the power of God, getting delivered with one wave. I remember as a young man, and I still haven't finished with this woman. All I've got to so far is, I've had five husbands. I was going to tell you something. I remember so many incredible things over so many years. Maybe we'll look at some more in a minute. But here, the word of knowledge has cut through that thing. She's now wide open. And she says, sir, I perceive you're a prophet. Duh. Is she not sure? They had prophets around. There were some pretty whack prophets. People like Baal had got around over the years, and I'm sure there was more. We get people today in the body of Christ that call themselves prophets. We've got some good ones too. We need a lot more really down the line sharp prophets. Sir, I perceive you're a prophet. Then she asked an interesting question. She needed an answer. She said to him, sir, our fathers say that in this mountain, Mount Gerizim, we should worship. Your fathers say Mount Zion you should worship. Which one's right? And Jesus looked at her and he said to her, woman, believe me, the hour comes and now is. When the true worshippers worship the Father in spirit and in truth, and the Father seeks people just like that to worship him. Now she's looking at him a little different to 5 minutes ago. The wall is down. She's ready to get saved. It's the power of one word of knowledge. Just one word. And now she says, sir, we've heard that Messiah is coming. And Jesus said, I that speak to you am he. Well, I love what happened next. She headed down to town with a water pot. In fact, she didn't even take it. The Bible says she left a water pot. She headed straight down to town, stunned. And she went down to town and she said, excuse me, everybody. And the crowd gathered. She was well known. We don't know a lot about her, but she's certainly well known because she said, come and meet a man who knows everything about me. And a revival broke out in that district. Word of knowledge. Now, let me tell you a story. Would you like a story? How are we doing for time? I have a very good friend. He was on my street team when I was pastoring in Melbourne some years ago. Powerful street evangelist. He was the best street evangelist I've ever seen. We would be praying Friday nights. We would go from 7 o'clock to midnight every Friday night. And while they were out in the streets, we'd be praying for them. And they'd come back with the testimonies of miracles one after another. And they were a dynamic group. He and his fiancée were sharing with a young woman. And they would share with her and they'd share the gospel. And she'd listen for a few minutes and then up would go the wall. The wall that had been built now for so long in her life, through some circumstances, came up. She'd start to cry and say, do not say anymore. I don't want anymore. Leave me alone. Well, they shared with her a few times. She would start to open, then she'd slam shut. And Ian said to his wife, his fiancée then, he said, I'm going to find out. There's a key. There's a key. I'm going to get the key. And so he went on a fast. He went 21 days just on dry bread and water, seeking God. The end of the fast, he woke up, sat upright in bed, and God said to him, get in your car. He got in his car, and he drove down to one of the districts of Melbourne. When he got down there, God said, get out of your car. There was a laneway. And God took him into the laneway and said, in this laneway, this young girl went through a terrible experience. She was molested as a child. He went back home stunned that God had shown him. The only person that knew about it was the man who did it and the girl that went through the difficult ordeal. The next day, and of course God knew, because he knows a lot of stuff. He doesn't miss much. How many know that? You can't hide from him. You can't hide sin from him. You can't hide anything from him. He sees it all. Someone said, little kid said to his father, does he watch me all the time? Is he watching me all the time? And he said, yes, he does, son. He loves you so much, he can't take his eyes off you. Following night, they went down to see this girl. And they started to share, and she started to cry and say no more. And Ian said, I know why you can't find Jesus. God took me to a laneway last night. He showed me that something terrible had happened to you. With that, she began to cry and weep. She was set free on the inside. She finished up on her knees, saved and baptized in the Spirit. Because that word was the key. And you see, when Jesus said to Peter, I'll give you the keys of the kingdom. He didn't give him a set to hang in the Vatican. Keys of the kingdom don't hang in the Vatican. They don't hang there. So where are they and what are they? What are the keys of the kingdom? There was a key to your salvation. There's a key that took you from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. There is a key that will open a community. There's keys that will open a nation. And God says, Peter, I'm giving you the keys of the kingdom. But they're not just for Peter. There's a whole set of keys right here in this room. And they're keys to open the different nations we go to. There was a key to Nepal. There's keys in a numerous other places that are going to open. Numerous. 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 And there are keys to individuals that you know. And so what do? We want to reach people. One of the greatest things we can do is say, Father, I would like you to trust me. You bring the locks, and I'll pray that you give me the keys. You lead me to the lock to be opened. and I'll seek you for the key that turns it. And it may be a simple thing. It may not be something that you think it is. We need to be observing and listening to the Holy Ghost, because sometimes it's something altogether different. I was pastoring years ago in a big church in Dandenong in Melbourne. And there was a lady who would come to the church. She's a really nice lady. And she was married to a big truck driver. This guy's a big guy and he's a tough boy. And he hated her coming to church. And what does a good pastor do? A good pastor has to face the music. If you get a black eye, you get one. But you still got to face the music of going and having a chat with him. It's just the joy of pastoring. And it's the excitement, because you get the best stories when you're likely to get your head knocked off. Most dangerous countries are the ones you get the best stories. So I knew what time he got in. He drove his big Kenworth in. And I knew what time he'd be there, so I arranged to be there when he got home. And went there, and he was just in, and went inside, and they asked me in, she asked me in. And I sat down in the kitchen, and his name was Colin. He was a big boy too. And I thought, and as I sat down, he looked a lot bigger. And I just was there, and he wasn't too pleased that I was there. And I said, Cole, I said, your wife's been coming to church. She's been enjoying it. What do you think? And, well, he used some words that I had stopped using some time before. But I understood them. I understood that they really meant that he was not that enthused. And I said, well, you know, would you ever come? Don't be so stupid. And a few words again that I didn't understand. A nice guy. He just wasn't interested. And I said, Jesus, this is not good. I need a key. I need a key. Now, what is it? Is it a word of knowledge? What is it? I want a key. The key might be to go and mow the guy's lawn across the road. The key might be a powerful word of knowledge. The key might be an act of kindness. The key might be to go and pray for them in hospital. Well, I looked up on the wall and I saw books. And there was a book, The Essendon Football Club. I thought, my love for Australian rules football, I can see that it's been something that you've backing and you like me doing it. And I said, Cole, you follow Essendon Football Club? Yeah, I do. I said, you've got a couple of really good recruits. I said, one of the guys, and I mentioned the name of one, I said, I played in the country with some of his relatives. He's a good player. I like the way that he says, yeah, he can. He's good. And I said, this other guy you got from Western Australia, a little guy called Bahaja, a little rover. I said, that guy's good. I said, I watched him when I was in the West, and he'll fit into your side, boom, boom, boom. He says, I think he's going to go all right. And he said, sit down. And we got a couple of books down. And we're going through. I said, yeah, I like the way that guy plays. He's terrific. He said, who do you follow? I told him who I follow. He didn't like them much, but didn't matter. But we just talked football. I just talked football with him. I talked about what he loved. Didn't even mention Jesus after that. Talk football. Next Sunday, coming into church, I thought I could smell mothballs. There was probably in his wedding suit. That's an evangelistic exaggeration. Down comes Cole. Brill cream. Remember the old Brill cream? A little dabble, do you? Hair slicked back. And Cole walks into church, sits down. Well, I don't know whether Colin ever got saved, but I know this, that my son, so this is 36 years ago, my wife, we just had a little boy, and anyway, Cole was every night, he'd say to his wife, I just got to go down, I've got to work in the shed for a little while. He'd go down the shed, work for a while, come back. What are you making, Cole? Oh, he'd go down and work away. Then one Sunday he said, I want you to give this to that reverend fella. It's a box about that long, that high. Why don't you give it to him? Tell him that he's a good bloke. I want to give it to him. Gave it to me. I opened it up, and he had built a scale model with balsa wood, with plastic and everything of a big Kenworth truck. And he said, give that to the little boy. Give that to your little boy. So, what was the key that day? We're always looking for something that maybe Yea, thus saith the Lord, you, and that works, and you get them. But other times you're listening, show me a key. I was flying from Kuala Lumpur to London. Sat on the airplane, and I looked at the bloke next to me, and I thought, gee, I know that guy. Gee, I know that guy. I really do know that guy. I said, you're on TV, aren't you? He said, yes. Like, this is going to be a long trip. Yes. I said, oh, sorry. He said, oh, man. He said, I'm just tired. I've had TV shows down in Australia. And he said, we're on our way. I've got one day at home with my daughters. And then I've got to go to Russia. I said, how many kids you got? He said, two. I said, what, girls, boys? Oh, yeah, I've got a couple of girls, Izzy and Willow. And I said, look, I'll leave you alone. I'll leave you with your privacy. So you just relax. And I did. But I wanted to talk to him. There's a show. I don't know if you get the show here, Top Gear. Do you get that show, Top Gear? Do you get the English one? Richard Hammond, he's like Mr. Popularity over there. He's got all these science shows and TV. He's big on, very big on English television and Australian TV. And it's him. In the morning, I said, Father, I need a key this morning. I need a key. See, we're talking the gifts of the Spirit. Sometimes it's a word of wisdom to do something. Sometimes it's a strategic word of knowledge. Sometimes God will say, lay hands on that person. Well, I said, Lord, give me a key. And he said, what do you got in your bag? I said, oh, I got a nice big drawing pad that I'd put in there without knowing why. He said, and I had some really top-line pens. He said, start drawing. So I started drawing kangaroos, and some of you may know that I sketch occasionally. But I really taking my time and, you know, really putting some serious effort in. Not like when I sit here of a night with 9,000 kids lined up. I have to move at a certain pace. And I see the kids coming. Sometimes I'm exhausted and I see the kids arriving with books and bits of paper. And can you fill this? Yes. Yeah, it's been a tradition. So I've got to produce this book. So I got the pad out and started to draw. And the next thing, a little head came around. That is very good. I thought, ha-ha. I said, oh, thank you. He said, are you an illustrator? I said, I've illustrated a number of books and I've worked. He said, that's very good. He said, is this for a book? I said, no, this is for your daughters, Izzy and Willow. Finished it and handed it to him. He said, oh, this is so nice of you. I said, I'll tell you, I'll draw. Some of you have seen my famous flying pig drawings. Who's ever got a flying pig? How many flying pigs have we drawn? One, two, three. That's a number of flying pigs. All right, so for those watching online, you're probably going, where is he going with this? Well, you've got to be pretty much here to know, but cartooning is the thing we do. So I drew this flying pig for him. Next 3 hours, we shared nonstop, all the way till we landed in Heathrow. Shared the gospel. He said, if you ever want tickets, and I'd like to follow it. I'm going to follow it up. But the key, I think, to follow that is with a drawing. So that's not very spiritual. That can be as spiritual as a precise word. Now, other times you get, now I know our times, we're right for a few minutes. Other times it's going to be just a profound word of knowledge. I was in New Guinea, Papua New Guinea in the university. No one tells me a lot of things before I go in, but the speaker before me had been run out by a gang of rascals armed to the teeth with weapons. They didn't tell me that. And they didn't tell me that the same gang was there tonight to do the same. They didn't mention that. They could have mentioned that, couldn't they? They could have said, Pastor Tim, your chance of getting killed tonight's about 50-50. So I started to share, and these guys were getting ready to do something, and I started to share, and the power of God hit. The power of the Lord came. And I stopped my preaching and pointed up near the back. I said, there's a young man back there. You're from the Sepik district. You've got a mother and father, from what I remember, at Church of England, Episcopalian. You're this. You're involved in criminal activity. You've got this, this, and this. And if you don't get yourself right, the chances are that you'll be killed. This guy took off to his room. He was the leader of a rascal gang that were there. He was the head man, head charang. Well, we started praying for people. No one's interrupting the meeting. It's just going like a beauty. Over here, it's dead. Have you ever had a meeting where you pray on one side, there's nothing, so you bring everyone over there? Have you ever had that? Not normally. I've had it a few times. And I reckon there's a reason for it. And the reason is because God wants to get some attention over here. And it'll be a little bit dead. You just feel like, ah, not much has happened. So you go across here and boom, whack, bang. Think, yeah, all right, you come over here. So this guy had gone back to his room and someone said, someone told him about you. And they brought him back. He stands about here and bodies are going around all around him. He's just standing there like an angel's got him blocked. This went on for quite a while. Well, he was a mess for days, 2 or 3 days. He did not know what to do. He was the head of a rascal gang. Rascal is a criminal gang. They call them rascals. Rascals, we see that as delicate. These guys are not delicate. In the early days over there in Port Moresby, they used to have a steel room in the house so that if they broke into your house, you could lock yourself in the steel room so you don't get killed. That's how bad it was. And it's still some very rough areas. It's changing, but it's been rough over the years. It's the greatest place. If you're watching from Papua New Guinea, I love that country. I love PNG. PNG has my heart. I've done 42 crusades in there. Love the place. Love every Papua New Guinean. Everyone. Can't wait to get back. Soon. Well, this guy gave his life to Christ. I was doing a big crusade in the stadium. There's a knock on the door of my hotel. And I said, come in. And a guy walked in, a big Papua New Guinean guy in a pinstriped suit, sharp-looking guy. And he says, deep voice, Pastor Tim, you don't recognize me, do you? I said, not really. And he told the story. He said he'd been leading this rascal gang and studying law by day. From there, he had been dramatically saved, and he was now preaching to thousands of young people, 10,000 here, big rallies all over the country. He went on to hold a very high position in government, and he said that night that one word shaped his life, but shaped a lot of others. And so what we need to realize is that the gifts of the Spirit are not just for the people behind the pulpit. They're yours. Well, that's if you think the Bible's yours. That's if you actually believe that Corinthians is yours. That you actually believe that where it says desire earnestly the spirituals, the things of the Spirit, especially that you might prophesy. Something about a good prophetic word. Something about a word that suddenly cuts the atmosphere and everybody goes. See? Hallelujah. Gifts of the Spirit. One manifestation of power. Jesus crossed over to the Gadarenes, left Capernaum, crossed, went across Sea of Galilee, headed across to the Gadarenes. There was a demoniac, a man who, well known in his town, he'd probably been stoned and kicked out of there numerous times, maybe had a family there, certainly had friends back there, and family. But he was so wild and so crazy that they would try to chain him and the chains wouldn't hold him. And the torment was so great that he would cut himself with stones until his body was covered in blood as he lived in torment, screaming and crying in the caves. Until one day, he, and I think there was others up there as well, but he's the one that's talked about, he saw a boat coming. He'd heard the storm in the night. The storm must have terrified him. The lightning flashing in the storm must have terrified him. And in his torment, he probably hid in that cave. And then when it ceased, he got up, and as the sun was just starting to come, he looked, and there was a sail of a boat that had come through that storm and not sunk. And something within him pulled him, and he ran to the beach. When he got down there, the boat was pulled to the shore, and he saw a man in a white robe, and over him was something that was magnetic. And despite being full of a legion of demons, he ran and threw himself down at the feet of him, this man. In a few minutes, we know the story that a legion of pigs, a legion's 6,600, 6,000 plus auxiliaries, about 6,500 men. And demons came out of him, screaming and shrieking into the pigs, and the pigs ran down the bank, and it was the first example in the Bible of deviled ham. The Bible says that the people came, and the terror of what had happened. Here's a bloke sitting in his right mind, and the terror, the Bible says, they besought him that he might get out of the district. They besought him, go! Go! Begged him, get out of here! Jesus got back in the boat with his disciples and they left. But later on, that man had gone back to his family, gone back into that place, and they saw him in his right mind. And only had one testimony, but his testimony was, I was demon-possessed, but I met a man who set me free. And then he went to 10 cities, the 10 cities of Decapolis. And those 10 cities were so impacted and so charged by the power of God and so impacted by this man's testimony because of one miracle of deliverance. Now 10 cities are waiting desperately to see him. And when he arrived, word went everywhere. And the exact same word is used. They besought him that they might just touch the hem of his garment. And they brought them on beds, beseeching him that they might just touch him. And revival filled that community because of one miracle of deliverance. You go into the scriptures, Dorcas led to a great move of God. There's others. You go in and look again and again. Just one man in the synagogue, set free. They marvel. They said, what word is this? Because he just spoke with authority, and even the demons come out and they followed him, and it was the Sabbath, so they waited till after the sunset. And they waited at Peter's house. And Peter raised up his mother-in-law. Always good to be in good standing with your mother-in-law. Raised her up. When he went outside, there's a multitude waiting. Great host. They'd seen a deliverance and they came in the multitudes. What do miracles do? They break down the walls. They break down the doubts. They break down the strongholds and they usher in the power of God. And the beautiful thing about it is that you and I are called to carry his miracle power. When you were baptized in the Holy Ghost, the Bible says you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you to be witnesses of me, both in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the remotest parts of the earth. The remotest part of the earth is, I think, Wellington, New Zealand, and I've been over there a number of times. But he says you shall receive power. The word dunamis, dynamic, miraculous, enabling, the ability. Divine ability, miraculous ability. If you want to boil it down, I think you could just about the Tim Hall translation, you shall receive the divine, miraculous capacity to be able to do what Jesus did. But Jesus said, greater are you going to do, because I've gone to the Father. God wants to use you. God wants to use you. There's no limit. God wants to crack nations open. God wants to give us keys. I want us to do something for just this last minute, couple of minutes. I want you to, if God's just stirring you right now, at home also, just watching, if God's stirring you, I want you to stand for a moment. And there may be people you want to reach that you haven't been able to reach. There may be neighbors you want to reach. There may be a school you want to reach. Maybe a university you want to reach. It only needs one person under a mighty moving of the Spirit of God to take one key and put it into that lock. And as you walk around outside church, I want you to look and see that everywhere you go, there are locks waiting for someone to put the key in and turn them. And if we don't wait for the key, the locks will keep walking around. But I want you to do something with me just in this last few moments. I wonder how many of you standing here watching online would say, I'm just an ordinary person, but I want to go into your stronghold. I want to go into the armory. But I want you also to trust me with keys to people's lives. And I'm going to seek you. You bring the people along, and I will seek you to carry that key ready to turn the lock. So I want you to pray this prayer with me. Dear Heavenly Father, would you place keys in my hands? I am ready. I'm ready to do extraordinary things. I want to open locks. I want keys. God, trust me with them. I'll seek you for them. And God, if you give them to me, I'll use them. For the glory of your name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Mark.
Powerful. Powerful. I mean, I was feeling the exact same thing. That's exactly what I was going to do if Tim called me up before he just did that. That's what I was going to do. He just did it better than I would do it.
Now,
here's what we're going to do. In addition to that, the armory is open. The armory's open. No, it's open. It's open. And so I want you to say with me, say, Father, I take the word of knowledge. Go ahead and give me the word of wisdom and also the discerning of spirits. And Father, the working of miracles, and let me have every one of them. No limited supply, all the different kinds, and Lord, the various gifts of healing. Oh, Father, that the glory of Jesus may shine brighter through my life than it has in anybody's life since you rose up from the dead and poured out the Holy Ghost. I want to move in the Spirit of the Lord like no one ever before me did. And I go ahead and take the gift of faith, prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues, all the mighty deeds, all the mighty works, all those that you did, and greater ones. Amen.
Millie went to ground.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Yes.
Woo. Do it now. Super parama. Thank you, Father. It's now. Yes. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah.
That'll work.
Hallelujah.
That'll work.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now in Jesus' name, you walk in the confidence and the authority of it. You walk in the authority of it. You walk in the authority of it. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. We love all of you. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. We know that you're richly blessed. Hallelujah. Find a bunch of people, hug them, tell them you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. See you on Sunday morning.
Here was my Greek.